back. We're live. The 5 o'clock rock. You know, this is like the 13th inning, something. And we do it on Thursdays. We call it ThinkTech Tutorial. And it's an opportunity for the host to actually get to talk to each other. You know, we come in at odd times during the week. We're passing ships in the night. We don't necessarily see the other guy. So this is on Thursday, we get to talk to the other guy and share notes and tips and tricks and comments and reactions. And we tell people how we really feel. We do it in public, we do it, but we really do it for the hosts so that they can express themselves, and other hosts, I know you're out there, are listening and learn from this. And so that's what the ThinkTech Tutorial is all about. And this one is featuring Carol Monley, Vice President and Chief Operating Officer of ThinkTech Hawaii Inc., a 501c3 Hawaii nonprofit corporation. Welcome to the show, Carol.
Thank you, Jay. And this is Minky Monley, our mascot, our corporate mascot. Say hi, everybody.
Hi. Hi, Mommy.
I heard that.
She's a little nervous to start.
If you watch our OC16 movies, you know that Minky Monley is in every single one of them.
Yes.
Every single one. Okay, and sitting in the gender sandwich, no, I shouldn't say that. If we had a gender sandwich, Carol would be in the middle. The sitting in the middle, okay, is Carl Campagna, and he's running, what's the name of the show again?
Education Movers, Shakers, and Reformers.
Education Movers, Shakers.
Yes.
Education Movers and Shakers, and it's at noon on Wednesdays.
On Wednesdays.
Very important show, very important subject. And P.S., Carl is running for office. I had to say that.
Thank you, yes. Yeah. I'm running,
full disclosure.
Running for state senate.
Running for the state senate. So,
yes.
And he agreed to come down here on short notice today. We really appreciate that, Carl. And
yeah,
we're calling this show, N'aie pas peur. Don't be afraid. to host, je suis là. We're here for you. Okay? Of course, the other is go with the flow. To address, calling all hosts, go with the flow.
Go with the flow. Just go with it.
So the first question, I mean, this is random, really. We're just sort of schmoozing here. It's after hours. This is where you get to see how sausage is made at ThinkTech. Let's talk about teleprompters, because it has been revealed, Carl, that you use a teleprompter. Nobody would ever know. Why do you do that? How do you do that? And what's the benefit of it?
Sure. I use the teleprompter at the beginning of the show, really only. And that's because it's a fairly long little introduction piece that I change their variables from week to week based on who the guest is. So therefore, I want to make sure that I'm on it, want to make sure that I'm saying the names correctly, want to make sure that I'm putting their titles correctly, and some of the background. So therefore, I will use the teleprompter to make sure that I'm starting off on the right tone.
Why don't you just do it extemporaneously from recollection?
because it's not always possible to remember everything, especially when you're sitting there and it's live and it's go. You're like, okay, and I need to remember everything and everybody and where the camera is. So it's great to start that way. And that actually, for me, it's a good way to just sink me into the show. Then immediately within that, I then introduce the guests for the day. And then we start with the first, you know, couple of questions.
So important. The first couple minutes is so important.
Yeah.
Set the stage, introduce people, you know, and as soon as that's over, as soon as your introduction is over, you got to get right in.
Yes.
You have to introduce your guests, you know, immediately after you introduce the show. You were going to say something, Carol?
Yeah, I wanted to ask, Carl, how do you get the information onto the teleprompter? Do you email it to Zuri? Do you bring in a flash drive?
I bring in a flash drive.
So right before the show?
Yes.
Within the 15-minute break between the two shows, you give it to Zuri?
Or I give it to Nick, or I give it to whoever is actually out here, and they plug it into the computer over there, and then they're able to put it up onto the teleprompter.
Oh, really fast.
Yes.
Okay.
So really simple, that easy. I usually write it that morning to make sure that it's correct for who the guest is and go from there.
Okay, great.
How long is it?
30 seconds or so. It's not real long.
Yeah.
It's not real long.
But you're right. You want to be totally articulate for that time.
Yes.
So you can get going on the right foot.
Absolutely. It really, for me, it sinks me into the interview mode.
Yeah.
Because then it naturally just leads to the interviewees, and then the first couple of questions. And then from there, it is literally go with the flow from there.
Yeah.
Until I get the cue to say, okay, it's time to go to a break. I'm like, okay, I need to find a break now. Right. And Zuri's amazing at that. So.
She is amazing. Zuri, did you hear that?
I feel like Alexa, Zuri. I'm here. Yes, and I definitely agree. You know, I feel like the teleprompter is a great way to start out the show, especially if you know that you might get a little tripped up in the beginning. You have everything right there. You don't have to worry about repeating yourself. But on the flip side, Carol Mon Lee never starts with a teleprompter, and that works great. So let's hear more about that, Carol.
Right. I never start. I haven't even thought to use a teleprompter, but mostly because, first of all, I usually know my guests very well. But also, I use a piece of paper, and I kind of take after Jay because Jay always has a piece of paper. And I divide it into three sections, which is for one of the three different segments. But the top, I always put the name of the show, which I sometimes forget to repeat, and then the name of my guests and their affiliation. So that, for me, works.
Yes. Yes.
And Jay, how do you do it all these years? You just
sometimes I really mess it up, you know? That's why I'm envious about Carl, because, you know, if you do a good opening, it sort of, it casts a, you know, it has a great import to the show itself. It makes you feel good, makes them feel good. Everything is robust, solid, organized, structured, you know, it's good to have that. And if you mess it up, and which I often do, by, you know, wrong pronunciation of the name, or I forget part of it and all that, so, you know, it's not as good, it's not as good. So anyway, that's, you know, I think it's a good idea. For me, I'd rather mess it up.
Sure. I also use a piece of paper because I will write some notes sometimes throughout the conversation.
Yeah.
But I do have a number of questions written out in case I get stuck or in case, and actually Zuri also will every now and then remind me, by the way, follow up on that. I'm like, okay, great.
Can we stop right there?
Sure.
Zuri, I got to tell you, your comments in the ear are just fabulous. And I mean, I know that sometimes I don't hear it right. But if you repeat it, I do. And in any event, you know, they are really useful, really important. It helps me remember where I am. It helps me, you know, go out of the box sometimes, things I would never have thought about. So let me say kudos to Zuri for that.
Yes.
Thank you guys so much. I feel like, you know, I'm learning so much just from listening to your conversation that I can't help but want to learn a little bit more. So that's where I would maybe ask a question in your ear or, you know, plant a little bug so you can start steering that way. But these shows are incredible.
You have a very high batting average, really, of good questions, good comments to help the track of the show.
Absolutely. One of the things that I think is important is when you're in the middle of the show, you're asking questions. Sometimes you get caught up in the conversation and not thinking so much about the show. Maybe there's, and that's where having the third eye and the extra set of ears listening to what you're saying helps keep you back on, get you back on track.
And that's quietly,
exactly. So every now and then Zuri's like, by the way, ask about that. Follow up on this point. Like, oh, that's really good. And I give her full credit every time, I believe.
Thank you. You know, while we're at it, I also feel like there are times that I cut in and I might be a little disruptive. So maybe we want to talk about that and what you would do if maybe I throw you off on a show. Has that happened to anybody?
Well, you know, yesterday, Zuri, and I host Life in the Law, which I've just been doing for the last few months. I think you told me it was time to go for a break, but I wasn't quite sure. So if you recall, I actually said on the air, Zuri, are we going for a break? And you said yes, and I felt, well, that was fine. I didn't mind having to say it out loud. But yeah, I just was engrossed in the conversation with my guest, and I didn't quite hear you said that it was break time. So maybe it would be good if you don't see me winding down to repeat, you know, again, 5 seconds for a break or something.
Thank you. That's really good advice. Yeah.
I would repeat everything, Zuri. And I would try to say it in a break, you know, when somebody's taking a breath. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, Carol's right. I mean, if you're listening to somebody, you're so focused. That's the, you know, it's a different experience. If I'm at a dinner party or something, or just... I don't have to be as attentive as I have to be here. I really have to listen to you, because I can't get my next idea unless I do. Which reminds me of, we had a show yesterday, right after I did my Boris Karloff thing. my face. And, you know, Zuri suggested I might have been a little bit out of sorts because of that. But I had a question, okay? It was the energy show. I had a question for them, and it was ready. I had my question at the ready. But then the answer to the previous question was so long that I forgot my question. And I made the mistake of starting to say, I have another question for you. Then I couldn't remember my question. And I went into, you know, like fragmentation mode. What now? And finally, I turned to the other guy and said, oh, you had a point too, right?
Do you ever get nervous? Do you still get nervous, Jay? Does it depend on the guest or no?
I'll tell you why. I got to tell you my nervous story. and by the way, that's the first time that ever happened.
Yes.
In all these years.
The learning point
that I would say to you is you always have the next question lined up, in your mind. It's always there. It's like that little deal that shoots tennis balls.
Yes.
You always have some balls.
Yes, the ball theater.
Ready to go. back in the formative days, 2001, right after the Ahime Maru, sinking in off Waikiki with a Japanese training ship was sunk by the Greenville, I was working for PBS. I was reporting for them. And the idea was that I would stand in a little X on the grass outside the community services building, which is just outside the gate of Pearl Harbor. And I would answer questions and I would talk to the nation, about what was going on in the Court of Inquiry hearing inside Pearl Harbor. And I would stand on the X and there's a camera about 50 feet away and I had a little bug in my ear. And I would go on for as long as this segment took. This was on the Jim Lehrer show, the news hour, okay? And there were 50 million people gonna watch this thing. So I knew an author, Fumiko Halloran, you know her, who has had a lot of publicity in her life. And I called her and I said, what do I do? How do I avoid, a problem? What is your advice to me about standing in front of 50 million people, okay? And she said, there's only one rule. Just hold on to this one rule. So what is the one rule? She said, don't be nervous.
It's that simple.
And I did, it's like in skiing. If you ski and you have 10 things in your mind about how you can better ski, they'll all flush out of your mind. You won't be able to ski very well. But if you have one thing, at a time, that'll help you. And I just kept thinking that was my commandment. Uh-huh. It was not permissible to be nervous. And I went through, I don't know how many times, we have a little plaque in the office about this. how many times I was there talking to 50 million people, I never did get nervous. I just kept thinking that. And so you say, well, if I could talk to 50 million people, then I could talk to two, whatever.
Well, how about preparation, though? I mean, first let me ask Carl. I guess I'm taking over a little bit here. But what kind of preparation do you do with your guests? And how far in advance do you line up your guests? So do you do a lot of research?
I try to get as far in advance as possible. It's not always, every now and then it's a last minute fill in.
Last minute meaning the day of?
Like the day of or the day before.
Right.
And so therefore what I'll do, I either know them or they've been referred or recommended to me. And then I'll do some research into what they do. For example, a week and a half ago or a week ago, we did the show with about the Epilepsy Foundation of Hawaii, and with Kathleen Sofosik. And I didn't know her. I have some friends who have their small boy who has epilepsy, and that's what led me to her. So I just had a little bit of research. So I looked onto the website, I found out a little bit more about what they were doing, and then I asked them. I asked the interviewees, what do they want to make sure to cover? Mm-hmm. What do they want to highlight? Several weeks ago when we had Georgie DaCosta on with the Hawaii Meth Project, I asked her, what do you want to make sure that we cover? There are so many things. And then therefore, okay, they'll tell me, I want to make sure to cover this and this, I want to highlight this. Great, then that's what I'll write my notes on. So that no matter what I'm leading to, at some point I have a question that I've written down about that topic.
Now, I ask you that because I'm going to ask Jay the same question, because I know it's a different answer. How do you prepare for your guests, and how often
I only prepare when you make me, Carol.
I know. I'll send you the research.
With certain guests, you know, who are high profile, or if we know them personally, or if, you know, it's an important issue, she's going to make me prepare. She can make me do some reading. She's going to make me figure out the track of the show in advance. And it is better when you do that. I will acknowledge that. But usually, I take a piece of paper, and I draw a cross on the thing, and that's four blocks. And the first block is usually, just as a matter of knee-jerk, is usually, who are you and how did you get into the studio? Which means...
Why are you here?
Why are you here?
Tell me.
Got lost in the building.
Right. And that'll include, you know, person and the affiliation and his role and all this. It'll also include his education and, you know, and finally, this is probably the most important part of that, is what's new? What has happened? Is there anything? Because, you know, top down, that's the rule. You want to do current news, something timely, topical, right now at the beginning, at the top of the show, to hook people in. So that'd be the first one. And that's one segment. Second one would be, tell us about your art or your science. Give us the detail. Teach us what you do. Educate us so we can sort of sit in your chair, step into your shoes. And you can make that as long as you want. It's just a matter of curiosity. And the last part is, so why do I care? Thanks very much, but why do I care? Does this mean anything to me? Does it mean anything to the community? Should it mean something in the future? Tell me how this is going to envelop, if it will, my life. And that's my formula. And I've been doing that since way back radio.
And you apply that to any guest?
Everybody.
Sure.
There's no exceptions, really.
I remember
and
the,
now,
very, the very first
sorry
time
to cut in, Carl.
We got,
sorry
yes.
to cut in, Carl.
Yeah, sorry.
Now it's time for a break. We're actually overdue. That was Jay Fidel, Carl Campagna, and Carol Mon Lee. We'll be right back after this short break.
Hello, everybody. I'm IC Davidson. Thanks for tuning in to ThinkTech Hawaii. One of the things that we do here, or the thing that we do here, is promote civic engagement in Hawaii. What does that mean? We want to talk about things that people want to hear about. And we want you to engage us and be part of that conversation. One of the ways that you can do that is by joining in during our live show via Twitter. How do you do that? Well, you get on the interwebs and get Twitter, get an account, and mention us if you have a question. What you'll do is you tune into our show live, tweet us questions, and our hosts and guests will address them accordingly. It's really easy, it's really fun, and I think that your participation in what we're doing here will help us continue the dialogue on very important issues that we're trying to cover. Sustainability, clean energy, you name it, we're on top of it. We want you to be part of what we're doing, because together we'll be able to make things change. Thank you for watching ThinkTech Hawaii, thinktechhawaii.com, weekdays 12 to 5 p.m. That was weird.
We're back, we're live. We're here with Carol Mon Lee and Carl Campagna. We're learning stuff.
And
we
Minky.
Always learn stuff.
And Minky. Let's don't forget
and
Minky.
And Minky. Our corporate mascot. Right. So you were saying during the break, I like that very much, about you know, how you prepare, how you track the show.
Yes, yes. What I was starting off with was, I remember the very first time you interviewed me, you talked about your quadrants, and I remember seeing your piece of paper with your quadrants, and you had a couple little scribbles in there that I couldn't discern.
You think I could?
So, I assumed you could. But anyway, yeah, so I saw that. So, when I first started about a month ago now doing the show, I sort of used that as a beginning. But that hook that you talk about is what I use, is why I want the teleprompter and what that first little introductory piece is. And for me, it's about, because it's about education, I look at it from the perspective of, well, wouldn't we here in Hawaii, of all places, want to have or expect that we would have world-class education, given the fact that all of our intertwined and intermingled cultures care so much about our children, our keiki, wouldn't we expect that we hold that education much higher. And as a result, then we kick off into the questions from there, in realizing that, well, we don't actually seem to hold it in that high stead. Well,
you're opening a whole new area of discussion, I must say, but that's what happens here on the tutorial. You know, what you just articulated is a message, isn't it?
Yes.
And that's the message, I think, of your show. It's important.
Yes.
You know, it's a simple statement. It's important. Now, you know, we're journalists, of course, although we're, you know, loosely structured and we can make opinions and all that, and we should. But it seems to me that you also have a message in every single episode, too. In other words, that there, yes, that's the message of the show in general, the series.
Yes.
But each episode has a message, too. And if you don't have a message, then at least you have a focal point. And when you open the show, it's a good idea to give that message. It's like our luncheon panel programs. That's what I try to do when I write out my thing at the beginning. You know, here we're going to talk about jobs. That's the last one we did. Jobs are important. We got a problem in jobs. If we don't solve the problem, we're going to go down the drain economically. So let's solve the problem. Here are the guys that can help you solve the problem. So that's the message of the individual event.
Yeah.
But I suspect that if I looked at your teleprompter language, I would find that it goes more than saying education is important. It's going to say, well, we got some guys here with a different slant on it, and they're going to tell you about this, and that's also important.
Yes, yes. The last piece of the intro talks about, well, you know, what we're referring to is infrastructure, is technology upgrades, everything that would be needed, deferred maintenance from the facilities, as well as treating our teachers and our administrative staff appropriately and respectfully. So it's really addressing that. And then from that, in today's conversation, we are going to be addressing some of these issues
right. So you're moving
with
the
this
needle.
Person.
You're moving the needle ahead each time.
Yes.
You're covering, taking another bite out of the subject
exactly.
each time.
Exactly.
Carol, what about
exactly.
you?
Yeah. Well, what I was going to say was that ThinkTech's mission is raising public awareness, promoting civic engagement. And how do we do that? It's through these programs. And each one of us, each show that we present has a different focus. Yours is education. Right now I'm hosting Life in the Law. Jay, you host so many different shows.
I just fill in around here.
Yeah. We'll talk about that. I want to talk about that. So I think all of us have hopefully that one driving force. The ultimate response is that we have brought to the public an awareness of whatever issues or topics or problems or challenges that face our community, and we can do it in this form.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, but you remind me of something I would like to do. It isn't going to be easy, but I think we could do it. You know, if I didn't mention before, the hosts don't necessarily get to talk to each other. They come, they go like ships in the night. And one thing I've noticed on other media is that when you finish a show on another media, and you know there's one following, you know, it's a good idea to try to hold the audience or at least give them a précis about what's happening next. And we don't do that. Now, I told you that there's this cross that I use. The fourth box is empty because you have three segments of 15 minutes. What are we going to do in the fourth box? I think what the fourth box is, and we've tried to do this in the past, but it's not, you know, de rigueur, is to tell everybody what the next show is.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Mm-hmm. Carl Campagna is coming on next. He's going to talk about education. He's going to talk about, you know, this special thing about education. Stay right there. And it's not so much that they will stay right there, but they get the idea that it's connected, that we're part of the same civic platform, raising awareness in many areas, and that we, you know, we cover the ground. So I think it's very valuable to do that. It's worth a given host looking at the board outside, list all the shows, and making a note to himself or herself that there's something to follow. What do you think?
Yep, absolutely, right. Yep. And that's a good idea. I guess my one question technically is that then a lot of our shows are shown out of sequence, obviously. They're archived and people can retrieve them without knowing what the next show is going to be or caring. So
you know
I don't
what? That's
think,
okay.
Yeah.
Because if I say that at the end of my show about science and technology,
right. They may research it.
Yeah, they'll see. The message is not so much that it's Carl, although it's very important, Carl. It's that we have, Carl, we have education, we have other dimensions.
There's something more to look at. There are right. other topics right. that yeah. are covered. Yeah. So it will make them, if they weren't aware of other topics, it'll make them look for that. Yeah. Whether it's YouTube and trying to search through, oh, okay, well, there's this person they mentioned doing this also. Okay, so you're able to see more. So I think it's a good thing, whether or not you're following it in a live stream sequence
right.
or just finding them randomly on YouTube, to know that there are others that are more easily found.
Statement about
subject
us.
Matters and topics that you can search about.
Right, right. It promotes.
That's another thing that I like to do when we go to promotions, our commercial breaks. I like to choose programs that are either relevant to the show, so maybe your viewers will be interested in following up with that show. Or else, I also like to mix in something completely different that your viewer might not have discovered otherwise. So pay attention to those promos. We're coming up on one soon.
Yeah. Oh.
Well,
funny you should mention that.
So Jay, I wanted to talk about, you know, for I've been working as a volunteer for ThinkTech for a long time, and I'm really a back office person, and I really resisted.
You'll get over it.
Yes, I know. And I resisted becoming a host until just, you know, this year when you couldn't take over a show and I stepped in. But I've been always in awe of the skill that you have that seems to stem from curiosity, just curiosity about every and any topic. And you mentioned just briefly the types of shows that you step in. So whether it's law, energy, it's Asia, it's endless. And I'm wondering, how do you prepare in life for being able to come in cold just because, let's say, a host can't make it, and you will step in. I know this, I see this all the time. The guest shows up, the host, for some reason, can't make it, you'll say, I'll take over, and you walk in and you're able to do it. So what kind of preparation
This is a really good question. I'm tickled you asked that question, but I'm not going to answer it until after this break.
Okay.
Aloha, I'm Kili'i Akina, president of the Grassroot Institute and host on Ehana Kako, a weekly program on the ThinkTech Hawaii broadcast network. Ehana Kako means let's work together. Think of the sad alternative, let's not work together. Here in Hawaii, with all of our diversity and the richness of the people, it's important for us to come together around issues on the basis of what's right, what's good, and what's going to serve the common good. And that's what we try to do at Ehana Kako. Every week, we interview movers and shakers, people in government, business, and other sectors of society to talk about how to create together a better government, economy, a better world here in Hawaii that can bless the rest of the world. I thank you for your attention to ThinkTech Hawaii, and we look forward to seeing you every Monday, 2 to 3 p.m. on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. We're Ehana Kako, and we wish you well. Aloha.
Okay, we're back, we're live, and we're working on a cliffhanger here. Carol, you know, asked me a question. It definitely was a cliffhanger, and I really, you know, relish answering it, okay? Nothing magical about it. I think anybody could do this thing about curiosity, anybody.
And it's Jay, I have to cut in. Just in case people are coming back from our break, what was that question that Carol asked you?
Ah, thank you. You're terrific, Zuri. I forgot.
The question was basically, you're able to step in last minute on so many different shows because we have topics, we have a dozen different topics. And I've seen you do this many times where last minute the host doesn't show up or the guest doesn't show up and somehow you end up being the guest or the host. But you can reach into your curiosity about everything in life, it seems, to be able to be interested and respond or generate questions. And I'm wondering, what kind of preparation do you have in life? Is it reading? Is it experiences?
Well, you know, my brother is on television a lot. And one time my brother teaches at Yale Law School after a long career of litigation in Washington. And he gets on the media a lot. He's representing Sergeant Bergdahl now, which
right.
is
his name is Eugene Fidel. If anybody doesn't know.
So I asked him one time, I said, you know, go on television, you know, you run down there to PBS or any of the, you know, the big channels, and you're always you know, articulate and informed about everything. How do you do that? Do you sit and read the internet beforehand? Do you write notes to yourself? What do you do? And he said, never prepare. I said, really? He said, I'm always preparing.
Ah.
My life is a preparation. So I'm thinking about these things beforehand. I'm never caught because they're always top of mind. I'm always thinking about them. And I would take a page out of that book. I think it's a combination of things. If you're a committed host, you're thinking about this.
Yeah, absolutely.
All the time. Absolutely. And you don't have to write it down because your mind is going in those tracks.
Except your mind is going in many, many tracks. My mind is going in a few tracks.
That's because I'm hemiphrenic.
I see. Okay.
What's that word?
Serious condition. It means going in too many directions at the same time.
And yet sitting still.
Right.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so that's one answer to the question. The other question, the other answer is the sausage theory. The sausage theory. And it goes back to listening carefully what the person is saying. Because, you know, in every statement, there are questions that follow. And every human being has the ability to listen and ask a question. I didn't understand that. Or what about this? Or how did you know that? I mean, it's a million questions.
That's actually a really good point. My very first show that I hosted with Corey Rosenlee, I prepared all three segments worth of questions. And it didn't take but the first 2.5 minutes of the first segment to realize none of those questions were great to refer to every now and then, but that isn't how the conversation was going to go. And as long as if I was going to stick to that, then my reply, then it wasn't going to be a conversation. It was going to be me reading a list of questions and him answering it. So it wasn't going to be engaging. It wasn't going to be interesting. It wasn't going to be as informative, and it wasn't going to have that flow of a good conversation that can really lead to something. So being able to listen and then just be naturally ready to ask the next question based on what they said.
Right.
And that's what I found out in the first, really the first
good
segment.
Good lesson. Yeah. Good yeah. Discovery. Yeah.
No, I listened hard too. I've learned to do that. But what I also find is sometimes my guests will use acronyms. And they will say MDP or something. And I guess maybe stemming from my own background in education, I always want to either repeat it and then have them spell it out. Exactly what is MDP? You know, so not assuming that the audience has understands that too. So my style has been fairly basic in that I always want to know the general, the big picture, understand the big picture, and I'm not quite confident enough to make really deep, challenging conversations yet. I haven't quite developed that style that Jay has very easily. But I will, maybe. But otherwise, my goal is to learn as much as I can for the sake of the audience. But that may mean simplifying, as I said, understanding what those acronyms are, or rolling back, explaining exactly. I love examples. I love stories. I love background.
It's a great question anytime, isn't it?
Right.
A lot of people speak in platitudes, and you know what we can do here is make them more honest and more candid,
right,
and say, why do you say that, and what do you mean by that, and what does that acronym mean, and give us some examples,
right,
instead of just making a flat conclusory statement.
Drilling down deeper into the thought instead of just letting the thought float out there.
Right. But I want to tell you about Mr. Potato Man. Remember Mr. Potato Man?
He's too young. I remember
too young,
Mr. Potato
too young. Man. There it is again.
Yeah.
Mr. Potato Man was a game, and it was a potato. I think it was a real potato, actually.
Yeah, you got it from your kitchen.
Yeah, real potato from your kitchen. And you would stick on these plastic things, you know, for a mouth and a nose and eyes and ears,
yeah,
and you could have a different kind of Mr. Potato Man every time, okay?
Just to cut in, Carl and I probably grew up with the plastic potato.
Yes, yes, we grew up with Mr. Potato Head, the plastic version.
I knew there was a difference in the generations.
Yeah, yeah,
they got one with a real potato, but with a plastic potato.
Yeah, and nowadays kids are introduced to that through mostly the movie Toy Story. We'll see the Mr. and Mrs. Yeah.
You're only saying that because you have young kids.
Yes, you're very right.
So this is about ideation. And I learned this on radio, that out there somewhere, I may be looking at you guys, okay, but we're not really in a vacuum. There's somebody out there. And I have him in my, or her, in my mind, because I have constructed a hypothetical listener in my mind. I see him or her, and I am really including that person in the conversation. And I am mindful of what that person may want to know. Mm-hmm. So I am the agent of that person. I represent that person. When I ask you for examples, it's because I am morally certain that my potato man wants to know about examples. Yeah. I'm trying to help out.
Right.
See, that's a great place to really begin and end in the conversation, because you know that, you know, and the reason what's driving me to ask more questions is I know someone else is going to want to know more about that. So that's a great point. That's a really great, because I haven't put it in that context myself.
You like that's doing good. This, Carl?
I do. I enjoy it. I enjoy asking questions. I enjoy learning. I enjoy meeting the people whether if I know them or not, and I enjoy being able to convey a message, and whether that message is we need to do more in this area or less in this area, or we need to. I look at it as, there are challenges, there are crises, there are issues that aren't really talked about or aren't very well understood sometimes. So what, certainly from an education perspective, what I'm trying to do is learn more about it, learn more about what the challenges are, what some of the solutions can be, and that's really what drives most of my questions. Why, you know, what motivates you to do this thing that you're doing? And then why, and what are some of the challenges that you're facing? And then how can you and what do you need in order to overcome this?
You're raising an interesting point. I think it applies to all of our shows, is you have inquiry, you have explanation, and then you have action. Yeah. Okay, and my potato man out there is asking me, make him tell me how to do this. Like, how are we going to galvanize the community and put one step after the other and actually do it? And I mean, I really like to do that. Sometimes you can't, but I think it's a very valuable point to find the line between conversation and action.
Yeah.
Hence, we have camera two, which has a bunch of graphics under it. The graphic I like best is a bunch of millennials drinking in a bar. And so, you know, so those kids don't really think too much about education. They don't think about education policy. They're drinking in a bar. So I'm going to give you a minute or two to face the tally light on camera two and talk to those kids and tell them why they should care and what they should be doing about it right now. I do this pretty frequently.
Actually, I've been doing that with my
put
guests,
put people on the
too.
Spot.
But you know what I try to do is I warn them in advance. I say, when we end the show, I'm going to give you an opportunity to speak to the camera and tell the community perhaps how we can help your organization, what message you want to give to the public. You know, so I agree with you. I think that gives them a sense of course, of ownership, but of also being able to make a difference in just being able to,
right. You know. So why do I care
exactly.
thing?
Mm-hmm.
What should I do thing, you know?
This is great. I'm learning. I'm learning just being here. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, well, tell camera two what you learned today, Carl.
What did I learn today?
Examples? I'm asking for
examples of what I learned today. Well, for one thing, I learned that everyone relies on Zuri. That's one thing. We all rely on Zuri helping us through, and she's amazing. That's one thing I think everyone has learned. Another thing that I've learned today is structure is important, a starting point is important, but being able to listen is perhaps more important. And making sure that the conversation is there and that you're providing them, and thank you for what you said, Carol, providing them with an opportunity to express their thoughts, some of their needs and intentions from their organization as well, so that they get that ownership. Mm-hmm. And so that was something that I definitely learned. I appreciated that as well. So.
And I give them a heads up that I'm going to do that. So they
so they're prepared for it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. There's no reason to surprise them.
No. Jay likes to surprise people.
He does.
He's put me on the spot before.
Oh, why not? So, Zuri, what part of that do you agree with?
I don't agree with all of it, only because I don't feel like I'm the one, you know, that you guys depend on so much, because I depend on you. You all do so much. Without you, I would just be sitting in an empty room. Thank you so much for all that you do. You teach me a lot every day. We make a great team.
Thank you, Zuri. You're wonderful. Carol, I'd like to give you the opportunity to close.
Oh, to close. But okay, first, can I say a couple of things?
Of course. Sure. Well, closing includes summarizing and leaving a message. Yeah?
So first, I want to say invite all of our viewers and our current hosts and our people who are considering to become hosts, our guests, potential guests, to, of course, come on down. Let us know. We'd love to interview you. We can find a show that would be a great show for you to be on. And if you have any interest at all in becoming a host, becoming a guest first is always the best experience, because then you know what it's like to be on this side of the table and have the questions posed to you. We have 25 hours a week of live broadcasting. We have applied for money through several sources to increase our broadcast schedule. We're on the radio. We broadcast live. We run our, how do we say that now?
We stream our audio on internet radio.
On internet radio. So you can listen to us at thinktechhawaii.com/radio.
Yeah.
And in closing, I'd like to say thank you, of course, to our fearless leader, our founder, president,
Jay Fidel. It's been great working with you. But I think you missed something on this closing.
Yes.
You know, don't forget to tune in tomorrow at 12 noon for Stan Osserman.
I didn't finish.
Hydrogen is a gas.
Right. That's our next show. And thank you to Carl Campagna, who has just stepped in recently to take over the show on education. And
doing great, by the way.
Doing great.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. I'm having fun.
You were made for this. You were built for it.
I hope information is getting out there and people are enjoying it. So thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Carl. Thanks for coming down.
We also want to make sure we thank Minky for being so cute.
Yay. Bye, everybody.
Aloha.
She enjoyed being here. Aloha.
Aloha. Yeah.